Tom, I'm going to change my favorite thing. I have to agree with you. Pro Tools, I couldn't be in business without it. But I know that the other that we had early on, we could have never developed, you know, something different that we did.
No,
but I could not live without it.
Absolutely.
Listen,
absolutely.
I can't live without it either. You know, it makes us fearless in what we do. However, it adds to the neurosis. And there's no decision-making going on. There's no one, you know. How about the vocal? When we had 16 tracks or 24 tracks, we had to make a decision.
I
went crazy with the Manhattan Transfer.
Okay, and did that punch work?
Yes.
I've got a question.
Sorry, I just punched a hole in your solo. We have to do it again.
Before we turn this into a podcast sponsored by Avid, because we're all loving on your product. It's a great product. There's no doubt about it. But here's a question. I'm going to start with you, Gary, because it sounds like I know what the answer's coming.
I'm pissed off right now.
No, I've got the question coming.
I'm getting angry. Go ahead.
Go for it. You'll like this one then. Okay. All this fixing in the mix crap that's going on these days.
Yeah, it's a good thing.
You think it's a good thing? Or
do you think
people should commit at the start, get the EQ right, the compressor right? Or do you think get it down clean and then fix it later?
Listen, you know, everybody gets what they get. If they have it in their heart, they're going to get it. But certain people have to make decisions if they know that the take is no good. It's just no good. Why are we going to save 90 vocals just to hear crap later?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I still use my decision making from when we had few tracks, even though I still have the luxury of keeping a few. This is still performance driven.
It's discipline.
It's still performance driven. If you want to spend more time going over crap and stuff, then do it. But if I know something, I'm not going to keep it. I just get rid of it and move on.
Because we got to the, I can't name the artist because it's
many.
There's an artist I was going to talk about now that actually I know that on the entire album they went breath by breath, note by note, taking each bit in Pro Tools and then comping it all together later. I don't think that's music.
Well, there's no question about it that you can do some incredible things. There's no question about it. But again, it adds to the neurosis of everything. I'm fearless on Pro Tools. I love it. You know, I don't have to look for that blue piece of tape, which is tails, which is heads on all the edits that we've made and stuff. But, you know.
Colin, because you said you were squashing the crap out of stuff that got you sacked. Are you a commit guy or fix it later?
Oh, geez.
Because people can do what they like with your gear.
I'll answer it maybe two ways. One, if someone wants to track with a lot of, you know, compression maybe, I'm kind of against that. I'd rather have more of a dry or not too affected signal. You know, it's a good level and that's about it. But as far as like, you know, to keep the track or not, I did learn that part, that if it's not a good performance, it doesn't really matter what happens with the guy with the faders. If you didn't sing with the, you know, rah, and you wanted, rah, you're not going to make rah from, hey. So I think that, yeah, I definitely was at the school of thought. You know, also, because a lot of my recording, I did just, you know, at some point, you know, after getting kicked out of too many bands, I was like, I'm just going to use Pro Tools and record myself because no one else wants to. But, you know, you can be honest with yourself and go, that sucked. Suck. That wasn't so bad. It wasn't good. So, you know, I think you sort of can get good at throwing out ideas or tracks. So I'm more of a commit when it's a good one, and if it's not a good performance, it's out.
Tom, you probably get a bad rap for this as Avid. We've made Pro Tools that people do this kind of neurotic performance and production. How do you feel?
It's actually one of my favorite topics, believe it or not.
Let's talk about it.
So let's go back to, say, Steely Dan. Before Pro Tools, they were neurotic and did some insane editing type things on hi-hats. I've heard stories of, you know, Gary probably knows them better, but just like down to the individual hi-hat hits, trying to move them around and stuff. So look, if it wasn't Pro Tools, it could be anything, but there was something magical about taking these 16 backing vocals and saying, hey, we're burning it down to two tracks.
Yeah.
This is the mix. Everybody cool? We're now erasing those other tracks. We're moving on. And in the days of, hey, you got one or two tracks to play a guitar solo, I'm punching you in. Oops, sorry, I erased that part. We're going to have to go back and do that again. Now, that being said, Pro Tools is very freeing because you can do a lot of fix-it type things and don't have to make decisions. But I still think it comes down to discipline as a producer or someone guiding the project that, no, 72 guitar solos and sort it out later is completely not acceptable. Right? It really isn't. There's nobody has time or should have time to do that kind of thing. And, you know, I will say this. I'm a very bad singer. I enjoy doing some of my own home recording and stuff. So for me, Pro Tools, Auto-Tune, and you know, EQs to fix it and compress it and massage it, I think it's a good thing for the average bear. But it's like anything else. You can over abuse it, you know?
Sir, you've made lots of albums. Are you committing at the you talked about your air band and stuff, so you must have been getting it right in the mic before you even hit the tape or even Pro Tools.
Well, with the C12, I don't necessarily use the air band on it. I wouldn't. But if I were using it on a snare, you bet, and I'll commit in the preamp that setting that I want on that snare.
I'm a big fan of printing EQ or compressions at some level. Maybe not, like you're saying, Colin, not overdoing it.
But then, you know, you've when you're dealing with a vocal, and I'm talking about just from if I have the chance to be the producer and help that artist to make it through it, the main thing that I work on when I'm working with them is to get them to go through the song and sing it with the heart. And you'll go back and find that you will pull tracks, if they do it four times or five times, you'll pull tracks from the first, you know, cuts from the first take that had the feel in it. And they can just work it into the ground.
That's right.
And so I like to keep it down as, you know, at least under 15. No, I'm just kidding.
Can I say, because
No, but you know what I'm saying. Get the people to give you the performance. And do all you can as an engineer to make them want to perform it. I remember one thing I learned from Dave Reitzis, who's here with us today. He told me, I want you to remember, it's not about you as the engineer, it's about how that singer and that artist feels out there and how you make them feel when they're doing that cut. And he, there, here these amazing vocals come out because they're in a place they belong and the place that they know you're on their side helping them to get it.
And I'm sure we've all seen producers who don't follow that and, you know, the singer's blowing down the first few words, and I stop. Let's punch it in there. They didn't even warm up yet, right?
I'm in red on rehearsals, you know, and you know, because you have to get a performance out of people, and so it's, you know, you just can't beat up a singer for 4 hours. You're just not going to get anything, and so, you know.
Well, the amount of times I've done the test vocal as the final vocal because it was the best performance out of all of them, because I record everything. I say, listen, I'm just checking your mic now, but I even record that. And often that's the vocal that ends up on the track, because by the time you get them stressed out with the red light on, you won't get a performance out of some vocalists. So, yeah. Can I say, though, if you think this industry is bad, you should see the way the film industry is going now, that guys are just pointing cameras and then hoping to fix it later in post. And it's...
That's why we have no music budgets, because they've done all that stuff.
Yeah. Oh, we. Yeah, that's another discussion. Yeah.
And they ate too much while they were out there filming.